Good morning, Lea Valley Church and everyone else who's joining us. Great to be with you on this sunny Sunday morning. Maybe it's not sunny, but here we go. We're going to worship God. We're going to gather together in our lounges, in our rooms around this nation, around the nations, I hope. And we're going to celebrate and worship because Jesus is alive. He's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. God is in control of everything and we're going to worship him. He is worthy, you know. And we're not coming with a shopping list for God. We just want to give God the glory. Let's just worship God. Let's pray. Let's stand wherever you are. Let's stand and let's pray and devote today, this morning, to Jesus. Father, we thank you that we get to celebrate and we get to worship and we get to praise and honor the name of Jesus because you've given us salvation. You've given us revelation. You've opened our eyes and we can see and know you are the King of Kings. Jesus, you are the Lord of Lords. Father, we love you. Jesus, we adore you. Spirit, have your way in us today in Jesus' name. Let's worship and let's worship in spirit and in truth. Thank you.
Oh, shame is a prison as cruel as the grave. Shame is a robber and he's come to take my name. But love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no
we'll be right back. Jesus, that your death on the cross was victory over sin and death. And we are no longer bound to be slaves to sin. Thank you that you have conquered death. You are victorious. And today we congregate wherever we are, separate but together, apart but connected, Father, and we celebrate that this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you that you are in control. Thank you for your love and devotion towards us, that nothing can separate us from that, and we just love you. And we come today, we come this morning in spirit and truth to worship you, and thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for dying on the cross for us, that we might have salvation.
You are here, working in
Yeah, hallelujah. We thank you, God, that you are the way maker, the miracle worker, Jesus. We believe that in your name we have victory. In your name we have victory. Victory over sin and death, first of all. We have salvation. We thank you for that. But, oh God, for those of us amongst us, those of us here worshipping right now, those of us crying out to you right now for whatever need, we look to you as the miracle maker. We look to you as the promise keeper, the way maker. And we thank you, oh God, if people are praying or believing for healing, in Jesus' name we pray for healing, oh God. People are praying for family members to become to know you, Lord Jesus, for breakthroughs in whatever area, God, we're believing for. We stand again. We know this, God. Whatever your word says, whatever we ask according to your will, when two or three are gathered, we know there's power in our prayers. We shall receive in the name of Jesus if we believe according to your will, oh God, we pray. We pray, will you bring breakthrough where we need breakthrough? Make a way, oh God. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you in your name. We don't need to try and persuade a reluctant God. You said that by your stripes we have been healed. You said make disciples of all nations. You desire none lost but all saved. So we cry out for those that are lost, of our family members, of our neighbors. Oh God, we cry out knowing that you are not reluctant. But this is your will, oh God. And as we ask according to your will you break through in people's lives and people's hearts. Bring revelation that Jesus is the Christ. And open eyes and ears, unstop deaf ears, open blind eyes and soften hardened hearts. We pray in the name of Jesus, make a way, oh God. You are awesome, you are mighty, you are able. Nothing is impossible for you. In your name, oh God, in your name, Lord Jesus, we believe you. Hear our prayer. We believe that you're with us, even right now. You're with us. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And we pray, oh God, for this nation as well. We pray for the United Kingdom, oh God. We pray for your will to be done. Oh Lord Jesus, we believe your word. Your word says that you place people in authority. Will you bless the government right now? We believe that you are in charge. You are sovereign, oh God. Nothing happens. Nothing takes you by surprise. And like Joseph said, sometimes the enemy means things for harm, but you can turn it around and use it for good. In the name of Jesus, what the enemy has meant for harm in this nation, will you use it for good? Will you use it for the salvation of souls? Will churches, I pray, God, I pray that churches will grow up and down the United Kingdom in Jesus' name. We pray for Israel as well, oh God. We pray for the number of believers to increase dramatically in these days, oh God, as your word is preached. As the gospel is declared, as the name of Jesus, as the name of Yeshua is preached and shared, even online, like it is being right now, we pray more and more people will come to know you and that you'll protect your people and you'll protect Israel as well, oh God. And we lift up the persecuted church, oh God. Will you remember those amongst us in nations which suffer extreme persecution, oh God? Believers that might be in prison, that might be suffering, that might be being tortured, oh God, will you bring comfort supernaturally right now? We pray for a divine comfort, Holy Spirit, a strengthening. And I pray that the church will multiply and grow like wildfire, like the book of Acts, oh God, in these nations. And oh God, we thank you. We thank you that you hear our prayer, you answer our prayer. Nothing is too difficult for you. Oh God, at your name, every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord. And help, oh God, help those that we're praying for to proclaim Jesus as Lord before they die, so that in their own free will, not after, oh God, when they face judgment. We pray for that in the name of Jesus. And oh God, we're going to say the Lord's Prayer together now. And we do this every week as well. It's a good thing to do. And it's something we can be united to do together. So, we're just going to do that, and it's the words are going to come on the screen any minute now. This is why I'm kind of like delaying here, but stay in that attitude of prayer. Here we go. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. And as we forgive those who sin against us, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Yes, it's so good to pray. The prayer that Jesus taught us together, you know, the Lord's Prayer, and it's so good that we can do that in one voice in many rooms across this nation and the nations. So before we carry on, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings now in church. On a Sunday, we pass around a bucket. We can't do that, obviously, but I want to encourage you with your online giving just to keep believing, keep God on the throne in your heart as the center place, you know. Keep trusting Jesus. Keep trusting God with everything you have. Trust him with your family. Trust him with your health. Trust him with your finances and your resources. And as we do that, and I'm speaking to believers now, as we do that, it's a simple act of faith. One of the simplest steps of faith we can take is to trust God of our finances and to be faithful in our tithes and offerings. And this is my personal testimony, and this is the testimony of many people who will get up here and say the same thing. You cannot outgive God. Of illogically, somehow, of all the years we tithe and offer, we can honestly say God has been good. We've never been without, and we've always been blessed, you know. And I'm not just talking financial blessing. I'm talking the spiritual, the prosperity of the soul, the blessing of knowing Jesus and of walking with Jesus. So let me encourage you. Keep faithful in that. And the details will come up, I think, on the end. And they're online as well. You can go to our website. Great. Great, great, great. Notices now. We are got something coming up. Thank you. We have got a big notice. I want you to remember this. On Thursday, we will send out another MailChimp to remind you tomorrow. But on Thursday, we have got our prayer walk. So if you're local, we want to meet at LVC Car Park. Details will be on the screen right now. And the time and stuff. And what we want to do is give you, what we'll do is we'll send you in teams of two or in families, you know, in your bubbles. And we will go around different streets, different parts of this community. And if you're really up for a long walk, we might send you down the Lea Valley, the River Lea, I mean, you know, down the River Lea. And what we're going to do is we're just going to pray. And we're going to pray for our town, our community, our towns, plural, our communities and our neighborhoods, plural. We're going to pray for a time, a season of blessing, a season of eyes being opened, hearts being softened, souls being saved. Wouldn't it be amazing if we come out at the end of this year, 2020, like so many memes and jokes about 2020, when's it going to end? But listen, imagine if we came out of this period and the church just, all the churches were just like growing massively. Wouldn't it be amazing if the churches swelled from all of this? If people started finding and searching and, like, you know, realizing what is going on, and people are really seeking about the last days and all of this stuff, and in this they find Jesus, you know? And there is nothing to say that that won't happen, you know? God answers prayer. And I believe that most of the best things that happen in my life and most of the best things that happen in our church starts in the prayer closet. So let's meet together, let's pray faithfully, and let's believe for a season of growth and a season of souls. So please come and join us. That is our major notice I want you to remember. That's Thursday. Details on the bottom. Thank you. Right now, I'm going to hand over now to Senior Pastor Steele, at least for another 2 or 3 weeks, I think. Senior Pastor Jeff Ace is going to bring the word, and I know it's going to be awesome. So please, please stay engaged. Get your Bibles or get your phones or your apps and follow it and let God speak to you. We're doing a series at the moment in 1 John, and so we're going to study that book together. It's so good to study books of the Bible together, isn't it? So let me welcome Pastor Jeff.
Good morning, everybody. Lovely to see you this morning. You know, God is our good God, and I guess for the time being, Tim can refer to me as senior pastor. I don't know quite what's going to happen after that. It's something I'll have to call him Senior Pastor Tim Goodman, I suppose. So anyway, it's really cool. Good to be with you. We're going to carry on with the series on 1 John chapter 3. And I've entitled today, Great Love. Great Love. Because that's really one of the real essences of this. So here's the context. And let's remember that if you take a scripture or text out of context, if you take the text, meaning the scripture, out of its context, you are left with a con. So we have to understand how everything goes places in. So Tim and Haley talked last week from 1 John chapter 2, and this is a teaching that's talking about the and addressing or directed at the agnostic teachers, especially the there's a group of Gnostics who were denying Jesus' humanity, and they were saying, no, Jesus wasn't, he didn't come in human form or anything. And so that talks about that, and they talked about a number of other things, the love of God, etc., what love means. And then 1 John then continues to make reference to the false teachers who separated salvation from ethics and morality, and there's a big conflict that goes on in there. And this is a pastoral letter. John is writing to the churches. They're in conflict. He's writing to address the conflict and to prevent its spread. And we read, last week we read about in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 19 of the problems in the churches that were caused by false teachers who had left the church. And it says this: they went out teaching false doctrine so that it would be clearly shown that none of them are us. These false teachers, they were arrogant, they were unloving, they openly denied the incarnation and the deity of Jesus and claimed not to be sinners. Oh, if that were true, that we wouldn't be sinners, i.e. we never sinned, you know, and they had this whole doctrinal argument. They openly denied the incarnation and the deity. They may have been, and these guys may have been forerunners of the Gnostic heretics who plagued the second century church, continuing to be influential. You know what? And the trouble is, there is still today, is that concern. There is a whole lot of host of non-biblical or extra-biblical practices occurring in various parts of the church and being promoted as the new truths that the Bible doesn't include, but these are new truths. What sort of Christianity is that when the word is ignored over experience? You know what? Warning, if it isn't the Bible, stay away from it. And one key guide to all of this is, if a teaching is based on one word or just a sentence of scripture that doesn't live with what goes before the scripture or what comes after the scripture, you know what? Run for the hills. Get away from it as quick as you can. So in the first part of this chapter, John has called these new believers to a high calling. And if we can have the scripture up on the wall there, we're going to be talking about, so from 1 John chapter 3, we're looking at the first three verses, and we were looking at it out of the Amplified Version. And see what it says there. See, so here we go. He's telling them that they are, these new believers, they are the children of God. See what incredible quality of love the Father has shown us, that we would be permitted, we're able to be named and called and counted as the children of God. What an incredible thing. Verses 4 and 6 talks about the fact that we're called to be righteous, not sinful. In verse 7, and it tells them not to allow anyone to lead them astray. Little children, believers, dear one, do not let anyone lead you astray. And then he draws, in 8 and 9, he draws a sharp difference between those who are righteous and those who are sinful. And he talks about it. And he uses these words in there. He mentions sin in there, and these sin verbs are words of action. They're processes. They're the conditions of a present reality, the present tense, what is happening right now, but a continuing action. John isn't saying here that believers never sin, but they should not sin deliberately or continually. One more thing I just want to touch before I get into that, and what I really want to talk about is, you know, it goes on in verse 15, and he says this thing here: everyone who hates, and in the Amplified in brackets it says, works against his brother in Christ, is at heart a murderer by God's standards. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. You know what, I am freshly stunned by how some believers treat one another through their actions and reactions. What they say and what they accuse other believers of, it staggers me. And what they are willing to go to court over and report the most outlandish lies and accusations is mind-blowing. And it causes me to really ponder on the possibility that are they truly believers, and do they really understand what it means to actually be a Christian believer when they want to pursue such things? Anyway, so that's the intro done. What I really want to talk about is from verse 16 onwards. So we're going to look at 16 through 18. And it says this, "By this we know and have come to understand the depth and essence of his precious love, that he willingly laid down his life for us because he loved us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the believers." Notice this, it's talking about believers. This is believers. This is John addressing believers, talking about how to actually deal with other believers. Verse 17, "But whoever has the world's goods, i.e. adequate resources, and sees his brother in need, but has no compassion for him, how does the love of God live in him? Little children, believers, dear ones, let us not love merely in theory, with word or with tongue, giving lip service to compassion, but in action and in truth, in practice, in sincerity, because practical acts of love are more than words." I love it here. The beginning of 16, it says this, "By this we know, we've come to understand the depth and essence of his love and of his precious love." And this word here, love, is the Greek word agape. It's a Greek word agape. And we use the word love in our context in the Western world in different ways. We say, "I love you. I love this cooler weather." I'm sure many of us will put up our hands at the moment and say, "I love this cooler weather right at the moment. I love the warm weather too. I love the color of that. I love this, I love that." And so we use this word love in whole lots of different contexts. But the Greeks had four words for love that distinguished among the various affections which we reuse in our English language. Let's remember this, that the New Testament, originally written in Greek, by Hebrew believers, writing in the original form of Koine Greek or Biblical Greek, what we refer to as Biblical Greek, or the which was the common dialect going from 300 BC through to 300 AD, and even now that modern Greek has its derivative from Koine Greek. So we have these four words, agape, which is love that is devoted to the welfare of the beloved. We have eros, romantic love or sexual passion. Phileo, friendship or brotherly love. Some people say that's why Philadelphia got the name Philadelphia, because it was a center of homosexual activity, and from that, Philadelphia. And then we have storge, which has to do with love between family members and can be also used in other ways. Most of them, the love that one person has for another is a blend of two or more kinds of these love. The two words for love used primarily in the New Testament are the words phileo and agape. So the word for love used in this verse is agape or agape. It depends on your pronunciation. The kind of love that is concerned for the welfare of the beloved. John says that we can know the meaning of agape love by seeing it acted out in the person of Jesus Christ, primarily in his death on the cross on our behalf. John 15 and verses 12 and 13 says this, "This is my commandment," this is Jesus speaking, "that you love and unselfishly seek the best for one another, just as I have loved you. No one has greater love nor stronger commitment than to lay down his own life for his friends." So right here, both Jesus and John say that Christians need to have that kind of love for one another, that we ought to lay down our lives. And then we must be careful not to misunderstand this call to necessarily be just a sacrificial type of love that Jesus showed on the cross. You know, this is not a call to some sort of sense of purposeless sacrifice. You know what, in doing somebody shopping is what is needed, then that is all that agape love requires of us. Agape love does not require necessarily us to lose our lives. It may do at some stage, but agape love means we are just expressing brotherly love, love to one another, that is some sort of sacrificial love. Verse 17 went on to say this, "But whoever has the world's goods, adequate resources, and sees his brother in need, but has no compassion for him, how does the love of God live in him?" See, this verse gives us additional insight into the meaning of what we had read in verse 16. John equates love. He equates love with giving material help to a brother or sister in need. And remember what I said before, John's addressing believers on how believers need to treat one another. So how can we claim to love our brother or sister with agape love while having no compassion for their obvious need for food, for clothing, for shelter, for general care, etc., etc.? And that, of course, would apply only if we have means to help. But the reality is, most of us have means to do that. You know what, and for me, this raises the question of whether our faith requires us to give money to people who are strangers. The issue is whether our financial contributions help such people, or does it simply encourage and perpetuate some sense of dysfunctionality in people's lives already? I guess the question we must hold in front of us is, are we in fact being benefactors or are we being enablers? There's a big difference between the two. You know, see, I'm happy to help people who I know personally because I know them and therefore can trust their situation. I'm willing to give food to almost everyone who asks, but just a monetary handout to strangers I have a real difficulty with. I believe that to do so, my opinion only, it's not something I would build a doctrine on or say we all have to do it, or please don't stone me for saying such a thing, but I think it simply encourages dysfunctional behavior to be perpetuated. Verse 18 says this, little children, believers, dear ones, let us not live merely in theory with word or with tongue, giving lip service to compassion, but in action and in truth, in practice and in sincerity, because practical acts of love are more than words. And James previously has referred to this in his comments on faith and work in James chapter 2, 15 through 17. If a brother or sister is without adequate clothing and lacks enough food for each day, and one of you says to them, go in peace with my blessing, keep warm and feed yourselves, but he does not give them the necessities for the body, what good does that do? So too faith, if it does not have works to back it up, by itself is dead, unoperative and ineffective. And Tim mentioned this last Sunday. See, while James is talking about faith rather than agape love, the principle holds both faith and love require action to help those in need. So let's go back to 1 John chapter 3. I'm going to look at the last bit of things of verses 19 and 22. Well, not the literal last, but just close to the last verses of this. Literally of 19 through 22. And it starts off in 19 by saying, by this we will know. Talking about a future tense. We will know that we are of the truth. That's what it says. By this we will know that we are of the truth. When crisis comes, when the chips are down, how will we know that we belong to the truth, that we belong to God? Well, here I give you a little bit of suggestion. We can use a principle that's been already established back in verse 18, which requires expressing love in our actions as well in what we say, what we have to say. 19 says this, and will assure our heart and quiet our conscience before him. See, if we love one another in deed as well in word, then our hearts can be at rest in the presence of God because we will know that we are of the truth. They see that confidence comes and boldness comes when we understand that we are of the truth, that we know God. Verse 20 says this, whenever our heart convicts us in guilt, for God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Nothing is hidden from him because we are in his hands. You know what? And even if we feel guilty, God is greater than us and he knows all things, it says. God knows that we aren't perfect, but he knows whether our heart is with him or against him. He knows whether we are in his camp or not. Verse 21 really talks about the concept of reassurance. being tied to verse 20, which explains how Christians ought to respond to the conviction of sin. And rather than seeing conviction as a reason to despair, we as believers can rest assured that God will forgive us. And if our heart condemns us, we can find solace. We can find peace. We can find a sense of that place of real peace and stability in God's greater knowledge and grace. But if our heart doesn't condemn us, we can approach God with boldness and with confidence. Verse 22 says this, and we receive from him whatever we ask. Aha, whatever I ask. There we go. It says whatever I ask. God, I want a Q7 Sport. Is it a Q7 Sport? I think it's a Q7 Sport. It's the big Audi 4x4. So I've got the confidence in God, and I'm going to receive whatever I ask. You know what? We should never live off just one piece of scripture, one scripture, and take it out of context. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 14 says this. This is the remarkable degree of confidence which we as believers are entitled to have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, that is consistent with his plan and his purpose, he hears us. There we go. There is a real key there. And if we know for a fact, as indeed we do, that he hears and listens to us in whatever we ask, we also know with settled and absolute knowledge that we have granted to us the requests which we have asked from him. So let me just touch on that as a significant qualification. Because if we do not understand God's will, we might not understand, God's will in a particular request. See, what we want might be very different from actually what God gives us. And the promise is that God will listen, but not necessarily give what we want. If we believe that we ask God and God answers all of our prayers, how come we don't always get what we ask for? Well, because God can answer in three different ways. Jeff, what are you talking about? Well, he can say no. He can say yes right now. But also he can say yes, maybe later, one day in the future. Let's not forget, we might not understand God's will with relation to a particular request. Number two, what we want may be very different from what God wants. Number three, the promises that God will listen, but not necessarily give us what we want. And number four, his answer might be no, his answer might be yes now, or his answer might be yes, but later on. So let's finish off. 1 John chapter 3, verses 23 and 24. And I guess this is a good little summary of the whole of 1 John 3. This is his commandment, that we believe with personal faith and confident trust in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. And that we unselfishly love and seek the best for one another, just as he commanded us. The one who habitually keeps his commandments, obeying his word and following his precepts, abides and remains in him. Abides. I think Haley talked about abides last week. And he in him. And by this we know and have the proof that he really abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us as a gift. This is his commandment. I think it's good stuff. So, third chapter of 1 John focuses mostly on the concept of love. And I've only just barely touched on a few things in here. Because of his love, God not only calls us his children, he actually makes us his children. He doesn't just say, well, you are my child. We literally become his child. John also explains how sin, including hate, is never the result of a proper relationship with God. And as Christians, in contrast to the world, we are supposed to do more than simply feel love. We are to act on it. And finally, we must always live with the assurance that he hears what we pray and he always answers. But remember this, he might say no, he might say yes right now, and he might say yes sometime later on. So Father, I thank you for this writing of Paul, talking to the church, talking to these new believers. And I ask, Lord, that you would help us. And those few things that I've touched on today, Lord, that would cause some sort of interest and an enlightenment, stir something up, that we would be those who maybe look into this passage of Scripture more, Father, and that you, and we recognize the fact that you are totally reliable with everything you say, Lord. So help us to understand. We thank you that you're with us. You're not against us, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. So remember, folks, he's our good God. You know what? If you've never accepted him into your life, if you are watching today and you've never actually accepted Jesus Christ into your life, you know, this is not just a story. This is not just some pretend thing. Jesus Christ came. He died on the cross of Calvary. He came. He was the incarnation of God, God literally coming to earth and came to die for the forgiveness of our sins, that we would have a guarantee, number one, of knowing God. Number two, of the day that we die, we would go to heaven. And if you're at a place today that you have not invited Jesus Christ into your life, you know, it's really simple. It's a simple prayer that's just, you know, Jesus, I believe in you. I believe you died for me. I believe you died for the forgiveness of my sins. I thank you that you've made it right, that I can now be called a child of God, that I can come into that place of connection and relationship with Almighty God. Father, I confess my sins and I ask for your forgiveness. You know, something along those lines. You know, it's not a magical bit of words that is said, but something along those lines. So God bless you. Have a great week. And remember, don't give up. No matter what, don't give up. Keep pressing on. Keep believing God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all and see you soon. Bye.
Great word. Thank you so much. And there's so much to look into and so much to learn. And it's one of my favorite things is when we study the book and read books together, you know. So let's just go out. Let's have a great week. Of course, we have got something coming at... Are we doing kids' work?
No.
We're not, are we? Can you just stop that scrap there? Let me start that again. Great word, Pastor Jeff. Senior Pastor Jeff. And I'm not going to call you that in a few weeks. I'm just going to call you Jeff. No, he's the boss. And so that was great. Please have a great week. Don't forget, Thursday we're meeting together. And remember, every day belongs to Jesus. It's not just Sundays, but this is the day we can do it together. And just be blessed and let's pray. Thank you, God, for an awesome, amazing time together, and give us a great week. See you later. God bless. Bye.